So for the most part, these robots that you see in the movies are fake. There's a man inside, a remote controlled device. Real robots are on Mars. The Mars rover is a genuine robot. And how intelligent is the Mars rover? Can you have a conversation with the Mars rover? I don't think so. It takes time for the Mars rover to recognize a pattern. Now, if you have a cockroach on your kitchen table and you raise your hand, that cockroach scans your hand and instantly says, danger, danger, and runs into the corners of the room. I know. I live in New York City. However, the Mars rover, if you were to raise your hand to the Mars rover would scan your hand compared to all the patterns in its memory, and the Mars rover would say, is that a giraffe? No, not a giraffe. Is that a spoon? No, not a spoon. 6 hours later, what is that thing? That's how far we have to go before we have true robots, okay? So true artificial robots are simply not around the corner. Maybe in the future, we'll have robots smarter than a bug. So if robots have the intelligence of a bug, why not make them look like bugs? These are the bug bots. Their descendants are on the planet Mars now. So what about emotional robots? It turns out that you really want robots to have emotions. Now, why is that? Certain people have brain lesions in a car accident, or they have disease. The front part, the reasoning part of their brain, is disconnected from the emotional part of their brain. So they have no emotions that are connected to the front part of their brain. If you ask them to make a decision, they are paralyzed. They cannot make decisions. Decisions require value judgments. What is beautiful? What is expensive? What is nice? What is convenient? What is inconvenient? These are value judgments, emotional judgments. When you ask these people, when is the good time to have the next appointment, they spend hours debating Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. If you go shopping with these people, they're paralyzed. Everything is the same. Expensive, inexpensive, pretty, not pretty. So why do we have to have robots with emotions? Otherwise, they cannot decide on anything at all. So you want data to have emotions. Otherwise, they cannot make any decisions. So in the future, we will have robots that are emotional. Plus the fact you want to bond with your robot, because if you have an unpleasant robot, the first thing you're going to do is you're going to sell it to the junkie. So you want robots that are cute and robots that you can bond with. Otherwise, you're going to sell them as soon as you buy them. And here is the governor of California in a bad mood. Real bad mood. And the question is, well, are they dangerous? Well, in the coming decades, I expect them to be as intelligent as a dog or a cat. Eventually, they'll be as intelligent as a monkey. At that point, they might be dangerous, because monkeys have an independent agenda, independent of us. And so, yeah, we should put a chip in their brain to shut them off if they ever get any murderous thoughts. The other possibility, however, is to merge with them. One day, we will have the possibility of waking up in the morning with a robotic body, part genetically engineered, part robotic, such that we live forever. Now, you may say to yourself, that's an unpleasant choice. But hey, if you're about to die, if your body's been decaying, and you see the end, and you are about to die, and someone gives you the choice of waking up the next day, immortal, superhuman body, beautiful, handsome, what choice would you make? Duh. Now let's talk about time travel. This is a class two impossibility because we're talking about a technology thousands of years, perhaps, in the future when we'll be able to bend the fabric of space and time. Isaac Newton said that time is like an arrow. Once you fire it, never comes back, beats uniformly, goes in a straight line. That's time. Einstein comes along and says, not so fast. Time is a river. It speeds up. It slows down, going around stars. We measure it every day, your GPS system. GPS satellites would be incorrect without corrections from Einstein's theory of relativity. And the new wrinkle is, the river of time may have whirlpools. whirlpools in the river of time, and the river of time may fork into two rivers. And so then the question is, what happens if you go backwards in time and meet your teenage mother, who then falls in love with you? Well, you're in deep doo-doo. But what happens if such a thing happens? Well, there are many philosophies. My personal philosophy is that the river of time forks into two rivers. You go backwards in time to another fork in the river. You meet your teenage mother before you're born, but she's not really your teenage mother. She has the same genes, the same memory, the same behavior, but you're in a different parallel universe. So when you go backwards in time and you hop stream, you go from one stream to the next stream, then there are no paradoxes. All paradoxes are resolved. In this future, it is possible to go backwards in time and change your sex, go backwards in time, meet yourself, and give birth to yourself. But you've essentially jumped ship. You've gone to a different river each time, so there are no contradictions. This is done by something called wormholes. Now, where have you seen wormholes before? The first wormhole was introduced in the English literature 150 years ago. There was a mathematician at Oxford, a well-known mathematician at Oxford, who wrote the first monograph for the public about wormholes. Does anyone know the name of this professor of mathematics at Oxford University? The book was Alice in Wonderland. What was his name? Charles Dodgson. Professor of mathematics. He could not write this book under his own name, so he wrote it under a pen name that he made up called Lewis Carroll. Alice in Wonderland is the first introduction of multiple connected spaces in the English literature. Queen Victoria was so enchanted by Alice in Wonderland that she wrote Professor Dodgson a letter. Please, please, she said, give me your next book, which he did. It was a treatise on higher mathematics that he sent to Queen Victoria. So the looking glass gives you one representation of multiply connected spaces. So what is the shortest distance between two points? Usually we say a straight line, right? A straight line is the shortest distance between two points. But if you can fold the sheet of paper, fold the paper and bring these two points together till they touch, then you realize that a wormhole is the shortest distance between two points. These wormholes are solutions of Einstein's equations. They have exactly the same topology as Alice in Wonderland. If you have a black hole that is spinning, a spinning black hole, it does not collapse to a dot, it collapses to a ring of neutrons. And if you fall through the ring, you wind up on the other side of forever. So the ring is the rim of the looking glass. The frame of the looking glass is the rim, the ring, at the center of a rotating black hole. Now, of course, there's a debate among physicists as to whether or not you can actually make the trip. Some people think the wormhole is going to be unstable. Some people think that you're going to die when you go through the wormhole. All I'm saying is that, yes, they are solutions of Einstein's equations. Laser implosion, in fact, Professor Paul Davies is an authority on this question. You can ask him all the hard questions after the lecture about creating such a machine that may one day open such a gateway to perhaps hyperspace. And this gets us into what I do for a living. What I do for a living is work in something called string theory. And we believe that string theory may be, we're not sure, the theory of everything, with the option, perhaps, of one day, perhaps, opening up a gateway to travel to another universe. Okay, and now we're going to answer some questions that many people ask. For example, if there are aliens in outer space, then where are they? How come they don't visit us? Well, there are many ways of looking at that question. One is, perhaps they're invisible. Another way is, if you're walking down a country road and you bump into an anthill, do you go down to the ants and say, I bring you trinkets, I bring you beads, I bring you nuclear energy, take me to your leader? Or do you have a strange urge to step on a few of them? Well, if they're type 3, if they're galactic in scope, and we're type 0, We're like ants on an anthill to them. There's another way, however, to explain the reason perhaps why they're not here. You know, our Earth radiates. Our Earth radiates radiation. For 50 years, radio and television, there is a sphere surrounding the Earth, 50 light years in radius, expanding at the speed of light, containing the finest of our cultural archives, the noblest achievements of the human creative spirit, like I Love Lucy, Leave It to Beaver, and now joined by the immortal classics, Beavis and Butthead, Part 2, and Dumb and Dumber, Part 2. And if there's a star within 50 light years of the Earth, they will pick up our cultural emissions, and they'll be convinced there's no intelligent life on the Earth. So let me just now end on one final note, and then we'll throw it open to questions. I spoke at the Einstein Centennial a few years ago, and my favorite Einstein story is this. When Einstein was an old man, he was tired of giving the same talk over and over again. So one day his chauffeur came up to him and said, "Professor, I've heard your speech so many times, I've memorized it. And I'm a part-time actor. Why don't we switch places? I'll put on a mustache and a wig, and I'll be the great Einstein giving the talk that I memorized, and you can take a break." Well, Einstein thought, wow, I can take a rest. So they switched places. The chauffeur put on a mustache and wig, and he gave brilliant talks. But one day there was a mathematician in the back who asked a very difficult question. And Einstein thought, oh, the joke is up. But then the chauffeur said, "That question is so elementary that my chauffeur here will answer it for you." Thank you very much. Thank you.